No, I really can't complain. Everything is straight. I've been on the way. But everything I say turn into the real thing. I tell her run it up, cause you know it ain't a thing. We made it out the slums, words on the page. Everything is straight. I've been on the way. But everything I say turn into the real thing. I've been living like I'm famous. Like I don't show my face. I'm jumping on the stage. Like I'm living in a daydream. She quit to tell me I'm a fade. She ain't told no lie, she love it when I catch my cadence. She gone off the deep end. Pull up every week and I hate to let her down, but I'm in a fast life, so you know.
Like It or Not with Benjamin Dixon starts now.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, good morning, people. Good morning.
Good morning, brother. It is Friday. It is Friday, March 12th, 2021. How you doing, man?
I'm good, sir. How about yourself?
I'm doing good, doing good. Welcome to Like It or Not, where we're free to tell the truth and not care. Who doesn't like it? Rebecca will be joining us probably around the 9:15 mark. That said, man, it is good to be here on a Friday. Like I keep saying that every day is the same during the pandemic, but the closer I get to getting the vaccination, the more Fridays start to mean something to me. Like, cause it's like I'm almost gonna be able to go and hit the streets on Friday. But
I'm just gonna do something.
Like do something with my life besides go sit in my backyard and look at the trees, man.
Right.
I know all the squirrels in my tree by name, man, because I spent so much time out there. So it is time for me to get back to some normal. Good morning to everybody in the chat room. Be sure to hit that like, share, and subscribe button so that you can get notified anytime we go live. James, what's going on with you, man? Everything's everything. You got that shot yet?
Man, not yet, but man, as soon I pre-registered last week, so I'm hoping that I get that email that says, hey, we have a vaccination appointment ready for you, and I will be my ass up there ASAP.
Man, look, I finally decided to go ahead and look and see when I can get one. And like, it just said no. Booked, no. And I was like, you know what? I didn't want to get my hopes up, so I hadn't looked. I didn't go online to look all this time, and then I finally looked. I said I shouldn't have looked. I should have, because now I know it's probably going to be, well, according to the president, I should be able to get this before May 1st. Everybody May 1st, right? In the country should be able to get it before May 1st. Speaking of, let's talk about President Biden's speech last night. He delivered an address to the nation where, amongst other things, he directed states to open up COVID eligibility, vaccination eligibility. I'm going to get my mouth together here this morning, to all adults by May 1st. Biden also added that he could see life return to normal as soon as the 4th of July. Let's take a listen to a couple of the clips of what he had to say.
Good evening, my fellow Americans. Tonight, I'd like to talk to you about where we are as we mark 1 year since everything stopped because of this pandemic. A year ago, we were hit with a virus that was met with silence and spread unchecked. Denials for days, weeks, then months. That led to more deaths, more infections, more stress, and more loneliness. Photos and videos from 2019 feel like they were taken in another era. The last vacation, the last birthday with friends, the last holiday with extended family. While it was different for everyone, we all lost something. A collective suffering, a collective sacrifice. A year filled with the loss of life and the loss of living for all of us. But in the loss, we saw how much there was to gain.
Now, one thing that Joe Biden does well is communicate the emotionality, the sadness of the moment. Because I think one thing that we miss in the entirety of this year of us trying to survive is the fact that we have suffered a very significant loss of life in this country. Take a listen to Joe Biden as he talks about this.
We've seen frontline and essential workers risking their lives, sometimes losing them, to save and help others. Researchers and scientists racing for a vaccine. And so many of you, as Hemingway wrote, being strong in all the broken places. I know it's been hard. I truly know. As I've told you before, I carry a card in my pocket with the number of Americans who have died from COVID to date. It's on the back of my schedule. As of now, total deaths in America, 527,726. That's more deaths than in World War I, World War II, the Vietnam War, and 9/11 combined. There were husbands, wives, sons and daughters, grandparents, friends, neighbors, young and old.
527,000 lives. And setting the politics aside for a second, and I know this is a political show, but the humanity of it all, right? The absurdity of how we have become desensitized. And Rebecca and I, we speak about this all the time. Like we almost had to desensitize ourselves, because to try to grapple with that level of loss is, I think, beyond our human comprehension. But we just came through a year where not only did we not even try to grapple with that loss, we often pretended as a nation that it wasn't happening. And we pretended that way as a result of the foolishness of our politics, the foolishness of our economic system, the fact that they wanted to push us back out there to work without a vaccine because they needed to hit their quarterly profit margins. We have just come through a traumatic year. And if by chance this year we can get back to some sense of normalcy, it won't be without a lot of emotional trauma that we have to take a moment to really consider what we as a nation have gone through. President Biden also spoke about the various hate crimes and the foolishness of us being divided as a nation on whether or not we're going to wear masks. We're almost out of this thing. If people would just stop acting like idiots. Take a listen to this clip.
Too often, we've turned against one another. A mask, the easiest thing to do to save lives. Sometimes it divides us. States pitted against one another instead of working with each other. Vicious hate crimes against Asian Americans who've been attacked, harassed, blamed, and scapegoated. At this very moment, so many of them, our fellow Americans, they're on the front lines of this pandemic trying to save lives. And still, they're forced to live in fear for their lives just walking down streets in America. It's wrong, it's un-American, and it must stop.
That's the absurdity. The absurdity that not only is this country divided around whether or not we are going to send people back without vaccinations, but also whether or not they're even going to wear a mask. The simplest thing that could save lives, because think about it this way. Honestly, if we just did it right now, we could probably prevent 95% to 99% of the deaths that would occur if we didn't otherwise put on masks. Like, can you imagine being a frontline worker, an essential worker who is waiting on their vaccination, and some uncouth asshole comes into your place of employment coughing on you, and you contract COVID-19 before you could get a vaccination, and then you die? See, that's the absurdity of this country, and that is the foolishness that drains down, that drenches down from the top. That, you know, prosperity never trickled down from the top in this country. Ignorance has always trickled down. Bigotry has always trickled down. And just outright selfishness and individualism has trickled down from the top. And so many people have died as a result. And we're at the place where by May 1st, every adult in this country could be vaccinated. And if we just simply cared about other people than ourselves for one moment, we could save some lives. But that's too much to ask for America. Let's take a listen to the president as he describes the goal of everyone who could be vaccinated, adult, by May 1st, being vaccinated by that date.
First, tonight, I'm announcing that I will direct all states, tribes, and territories to make all adults, people 18 and over, eligible to be vaccinated no later than May 1. Let me say that again. All adult Americans will be eligible to get a vaccine no later than May 1. That's much earlier than expected. Let me be clear. That doesn't mean everyone's going to have that shot immediately, but it means you'll be able to get in line beginning May 1. Every adult will be eligible to get their shot. And to do this, we're going to go from 1 million shots a day that I promised in December, before I was sworn in, to maintaining, beating our current pace of 2 million shots a day, outpacing the rest of the world.
Now, the president still has a goal for the majority of K through 8 schools, kindergarten through 8th grade schools, to be to reopen within his first 100 days. I have not seen this clip, and my natural inclination is to say no. But let's see what he has to say about that.
With the passage of the American Rescue Plan, and I thank again the House and Senate for passing it, and my announcement last month of a plan to vaccinate teachers and school staff, including bus drivers, we can accelerate massive nationwide effort to reopen our schools safely and meet my goal that I stated at the same time about 100 million shots of opening a majority of K through 8 schools in my first 100 days in office. This is going to be the number one priority of my new Secretary of Education, Miguel Cardona.
I'm good. I'm good because it's not as though children haven't died from this. Right. And it's not as though children can't spread this to parents at home who have yet to be vaccinated. I have thoroughly disagreed with every single administration, whether it be the governor of our state or the president of the United States, Donald Trump, or the current president, trying to open up these schools before everyone is successfully vaccinated, because that is surely a death sentence for somebody. And one somebody could be me, could be you. And a lot of times in this country, we always think about the greater good because we don't expect for us to be the victim. I think for once, in a collectivist spirit, we need to take a step back and say, what if it was me? And if we think about it from that perspective, then we do change our song and say, no, we shouldn't be opening up these schools. I'm glad they're going to get teachers vaccinated. Good. Bus drivers, yes. Administration, cafeteria workers, yes. But children still get sick. Some children have died, and if nothing else, we know for sure children have the ability to transmit it to parents who may or may not have gotten the vaccination. So, you know, cool if that's y'all goal, but as for me and my house, we're going to homeschool these kids until they get vaccinated. Last but not least, it's a couple more clips. In this next clip, Joe Biden is pleading for Americans to do their part to get vaccinated, and maybe, very possibly, we'll be able to celebrate the 4th of July independence from the virus. But, you know, what is the 4th of July to the Negro? We'll get to that in a second. Let's take a look at this clip.
And finally, fifth, and maybe most importantly, I promise I will do everything in my power. I will not relent until we beat this virus. But I need you, the American people. I need you. I need every American to do their part. And that's not hyperbole. I need you. I need you to get vaccinated when it's your turn and when you can find an opportunity. And to help your family, your friends, your neighbors get vaccinated as well. Because here's the point. If we do all this, if we do our part, if we do this together, by July the 4th, there's a good chance you, your families and friends, we'll be able to get together in your backyard or in your neighborhood and have a cookout or a barbecue and celebrate Independence Day. That doesn't mean large events with lots of people together, but it does mean small groups will be able to get together. After this long, hard year, that will make this Independence Day something truly special, where we not only mark our independence as a nation, but we begin to mark our independence from this virus.
I will say this. It is, had Donald Trump done that exact thing, I don't really care about the politics of it. Sure, he would have won re-election, Donald Trump, but there probably would be 300,000 people alive today that are currently dead because we had a child, a petulant man child as president who simply could not convey to the American people that we cannot do this without each other. Instead, we are trying to recover from the idiocy of someone who found it laughable or even politically expedient for him to make wearing masks a political issue, wearing masks an issue of your bravery. Think about all the people. There's plenty of criticisms that I've got of America, of the office of the presidency in general. I don't care who holds that office. It's an office that serves capitalism and imperialism consistently, even your favorite president. But there's about 300,000 to 400,000 people who are dead because we had an idiot for the last 4 years who could not simply convey the simple message that we need each other to care for each other and put on a goddamn mask. So thank you, Joe Biden, at least for that much. And as he make this final appeal for us to all wear masks so we don't have to shut this place down again. Take a listen.
Keep wearing the mask as recommended by the CDC. Because even if we devote every resource we have, beating this virus and getting back to normal depends on national unity. And national unity isn't just how politics and politicians vote in Washington, what the loudest voices say on cable or online. Unity is what we do together as fellow Americans. Because if we don't stay vigilant and the conditions change, then we may have to reinstate restrictions to get back on track. And please, we don't want to do that again. We've made so much progress. This is not the time to let up. Just as we were emerging from a dark winter into a hopeful spring and summer is not the time to not stick with the rules.
So it was a meaningful speech, and I hope, if nothing else, that some person who thought wearing a mask was a sign of weakness, someone who thought that it was a political statement to not wear a mask. I know I'm being overly optimistic and overly idealistic here, but there is power in the office of the presidency, and from that bully pulpit, he has the ability to convince people to please just be human for one moment, for just a small period of time. If we can get over the idiocy of our individualism, our selfishness, and the petulance of our politics, we could actually save some lives. And I think, like I said earlier, people always assume that the people who are going to die is going to be somebody else. But slow down for a second and consider that it could be you. It could be your children. It could be your loved one. And at this point, the numbers are increasing to the point where everybody knows somebody who has died from this. I want to leave you with the last clip from Joe Biden, then we're going to take a break. In which he's doing what he does good. He does this well. He's looking to inspire unity and offering prayers for those who've lost loved ones. Let's take a listen in.
Over a year ago, no one could have imagined what we were about to go through. But now, we're coming through it. And it's a shared experience that binds us together as a nation. We are bound together by the loss and the pain of the days that have gone by. We're also bound together by the hope and the possibilities of the days in front of us. My fervent prayer for our country is that after all we've been through, we'll come together as one people, one nation, one America. I believe we can and we will. We're seizing this moment
and history, I believe, will record. We faced and overcame one of the toughest and darkest periods in this nation's history. Darkest we've ever known. I promise you, we'll come out stronger with a renewed faith in ourselves, a renewed commitment to one another, to our communities and to our country. This is the United States of America. And there's nothing, nothing, from the bottom of my heart, I believe this, there's nothing we can't do when we do it together. So God bless you all. And please, God, give solace to all those people who lost someone. And may God protect our troops. Thank you for taking the time to listen. I look forward to seeing you.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, everyone. Again, hope that you are enjoying the show thus far. Make sure that you stay tuned and keep it locked to Like It or Not. We got a lot more show coming up. But first, we're going to get into some of this good music like you know that I can. Good morning, everyone that's checking us out this morning on all our platforms, be it Twitch, YouTube, Facebook, whatever it is, y'all, Twitter.
Talking to the first.
Go good that you're here with us this morning, y'all. Good morning, Mama Chuck. These are what's going on. Esther, good morning. Alicia, good morning, ma'am.
Hit me so hard. Oh, I'm so sorry, girl, I didn't mean to.
Nat, hey, Nat Squad, what's going on? Good morning.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I
good morning, mommy. Love you, mama. Good morning.
What am I supposed to do right?
Brand, brand, good morning. It get it now. What's going on? Brenda.
What I would do for you to love me too. No, I can't.
Susan, good morning. Melanie, good morning.
Try to tell what you were thinking, what you might feel for me.
I appreciate that, it get her.
And I know that we've been out drinking.
Courtney, what's going on? Good morning.
Maybe this ain't for real. Oh, I'm so sorry, girl, I didn't mean to.
Marquez, anytime, you know I do what I can.
Yeah, I'm sorry if I crossed the line.
Chuck Diesel, don't break nothing over there, sir, okay?
Baby, I'm falling for you. What I would do.
Melanie, good morning. Yes, it's Friday. Happy Friday, y'all. What we call Happy Friday. Latif, good morning. Nikki, good morning, Nicole. JL, I appreciate that super chat, son. Thank you so much. It's one of my favorite sweatshirts that I got on this morning. Afraid not, good morning.
And what I would do.
Martha, you better twirl it out, Martha. Sensation, good morning, Sensation.
Say you love me, then you take it back. Say it again, say it again. You want my forgiveness, so say it again. You're my thunder of my darkest night. You just can't go back and make it right. 'Cause it's too late. Your time is up. Damn it.
was kind and now it's dark.
Hey, I Walker, good morning.
Cause it's too late. In a better place now. I'm not gonna worry, no. I'm not even sorry, you're gonna be the lonely one. I'm in a better place now. I'm not gonna worry, no. I'm not even sorry, you're gonna be the lonely one.
Say it again, say it again. You're saying you feel bad, so say it again. Only you can do that. My heart was open wide.
Mark S, good morning. I appreciate that super chat, man. Favorite morning, so like it or not, that's dope, bro. I appreciate that.
Your time is up. Time is time and now we're stuck. Cause it's too late.
Courtney, I sing these songs all the time.
I'm not gonna worry, no. I'm not even sorry, you're gonna be the lonely one. I'm in a better place now. I'm not gonna worry, no. I'm not even sorry, you're gonna be the lonely one. I'm in a better place now. I'm not gonna worry.
Yes. Like, I have a whole lot of music about it. Justice, good morning. All right, y'all, welcome back to the screen. My brother from another mother and my sister from another father. Yeah, is that it?
Sister Benjamin from another Dixon mister.
Sister from another mister. Good morning.
Good morning.
Rebecca, how you doing, sister?
I'm doing good. I don't know why I'm golden, and it's probably because my light...
I love it, though. It's shining, melanin popping.
Yes, yes. How are you?
I'm good. You all right?
Yeah, I'm doing okay. I heard you guys discussing from, you know, my frontline work. I heard you guys discussing Joe Biden's speech yesterday, and I was ready to get in on it as well. Yeah. So let's get to it.
I am tempted to address something. But first, I want to go to these clips from Fox News, because as much as, you know, Biden's speech was conciliatory and give us the ability to just do the simple thing, wearing a mask. Like, the standard for a good president is so low right now that it's a good thing that he's up there, because the last president wouldn't even want us to wear a mask, right? And you would think it would be no big deal. But according to Fox News, it was a bridge too far. Let's take a look at this first clip.
Joe Biden, he needs to pick up the phone. I suggest call Mar-a-Lago and, yeah, bring unity to the country as he says he so desperately wants, and thank President Donald Trump.
Oh, I thought it was going to be more on that clip. I thought it was going to be more. I thought we were going to have something to talk about. I mean, Sean Hannity is...
Ben, he didn't... I was waiting with Ben. What?
I thought it was going to be more, David. Run the next clip. Maybe the next clip has something in it.
Yeah, this speech that Joe Biden gave is the most disgusting, propagandistic speech that a demagogue, even a politician, has ever given. It is pathetic. And
Okay. I guess if we play them in succession...
But yes, the you know what's funny? I did watch it off of the Fox News network, and that last 12-second clip was basically what most
you got all
of them,
day.
Yeah, yeah. What most of them were doing after the speech, and then when I went over to CNN, they know how to capture the emotion,
right?
So now they're playing a year ago today. During the pandemic, this is what we're covering. And then they were talking about, like, oh my gosh, the NBA is going to shut down and da da da. So there was two different views going on. And of course, we know Fox is going to break down Joe Biden, President Joe Biden's speech as something that's propagandistic, as you know, a bunch of BS, I think they referred to him as a demigod.
Yeah,
demigod. They're going to do all of that. And while I watched it, I know that for me, I did get a lot of the emotional aspect that he was trying to reach for, having that number right written right there on the back of his on a card that he carries with him all the time to remember the number, to remember the number, right? Mm. And it's interesting to me because when I saw them analyzing it on CNN, you had Van Jones there. Van Jones was just like, "Wow!" And when he said that he's gonna push to get the country back open on May 1, because that's what he said, May 1. He's like, when he's going to push to get the country back open on May 1,
this Van
we,
Jones,
can't
right?
tell, we can't say that this president isn't powerful. He knows how to get to the people, and he knows that he can get us there. And I'm just like, is that what you got from the speech? Because I didn't. But that everybody was pushing to me some kind of...
An agenda.
An agenda on both ends, right? Yeah. So I'm like, but not once did he... To me, watching this, and I feel like as the president of the United States, I need you to say something about, hey, we got to get these vaccines over to everyone. And I know that he said the tribes and everyone that's going to be included, but the people who have been marginalized right now, we got to make sure we get it to our Black communities. We are not, because they've been going through two pandemics in this particular time. That's the conversation. That's the conversation. Because you're talking and saying, oh, all of America has been hurting. Even on CNN, I'm listening to them talk, and they're like, you know, we were going through this. We were stripped of a whole year. Imagine being stripped of a whole year, then having to deal with, on top of that, risking your life to go protest so they can stop killing us, so that we can at least live through this pandemic to, you know, to fight the police officers again. Like, you know what I mean? So that's where I was like, dang, it's really sad, because a lot of us lost people to police officers, to the coronavirus.
I didn't know if you were going to say to the pandemic or to the police, and then it's both.
To both. It's both. And that's what I'm saying. Yeah. So there's two different struggles for us. And that's what I needed him to definitely hit on.
Yep.
And I think I expect too much of him. And not to and for everybody watching, not to single us out or minimize your experiences, but your experience even now through this pandemic, the same way it was through slavery, the same way how we live our lives here every day in this pandemic, your experience in relation to Black folks' experience is just not the same.
Right. Because I'm gonna say it right now, because once the pandemic over, it's gonna be over. But all this other stuff that happened, it ain't gonna still be.
Yeah,
it's still gonna be here.
It's still gonna be cops shooting us. It's still gonna be cops getting off with it. It's still gonna be the same. And that's actually, you know, I was thinking about who was that we spoke to, the state representative Omari. I can't think of his last name, but he pointed that out. That Hardy, thank you, Omari Hardy, and he. Y'all know my brain. You know, I had to smoke entirely too much weed. I can't remember anything. But anyway, I just digress.
Talking about Rebecca saying Hardwick.
She said Hardwick.
That's.
They just ain't think nobody heard. I heard, girl.
All I heard was Hardy. But you know, but anyway, it is Omari Hardy. But he was saying how in the Black communities they have to secretly roll out the vaccinations, because in the Black communities.
Mm-hmm.
It's an open free for all. Whoever gets there first. In the white gated communities, you can only get those vaccines if you're in that community. And so what he was talking about, and you can go check out the interview, he said it himself, is like they have to, in order to make sure that Black communities get the vaccine, they're having to do it, you know, surreptitiously. They're having to do it like in the dark of night, because otherwise people from other communities come in, get the vaccines, and nothing's left for the Black community. So he didn't address those things, and a lot of things that he didn't address, like why we don't have $15 an hour if you're really trying to, you know, boost the economy. Why are we at $1,400 instead of $2,000 like they promised, right? All these things he did not address, and it's just part and parcel for the system. But this is again the bar that is so low. It's so low for the office of the presidency in this country that just asking for people to wear masks is a marked improvement from where we were, but it's still not enough. And then, even then, we got one more clip. Even then, it was too much for Fox News. Take a listen to Laura Ingraham as she has her meltdown over this.
Well, what were the journalists saying? Their reaction to this pseudoscience? I think it was very moving. I thought it was really important when he talked about that July 4th goal.
He is the guy we need right now.
July 4th. Yeah. You know, right. he put that on the calendar as well. So
backyard barbecue.
Right.
People are going to be looking at their calendars now with some hope.
If we all do our part by the 4th of July, we might be able to celebrate Independence Day together, which would be incredible.
Was that Chris? I don't even know who that last person was with the mask. Who was that? Oh, Chris Hayes. Okay.
Oh,
now,
okay.
How is that based in any science? Hey. Now, I seem to remember a different reaction from the press corps who were crucifying Trump for pegging reopening to a holiday last spring.
President Trump pushing the country to get up and running by Easter, but top medical experts are warning it is much, much too soon.
We're going to have everything lifted by Easter. No.
The president saying, I want the whole world to be opened up by Easter. And think about what Bill Gates just said. You do that too early and you're going to be ignoring all the bodies in the corner.
Oh my gosh. I hadn't seen that until just then. Now, of course, the truth is the press was acting like the comms department for the DNC last spring. But we all...
Wait. Is she talking about last spring? Wait. Hang on. They're saying, they're comparing Joe Biden saying that we're going to open up for small groups by the 4th of July to Donald Trump saying that we were going to be back in full action last spring at the beginning of the damn pandemic.
In April. Okay.
Literally at March, April. I don't know, Easter falls in April, sometimes the end of March, right? So,
right.
Yeah, that didn't make sense at all. It didn't make any sense in the world. So for them to try to compare it, even if it was this spring, under Donald Trump, the way that Donald Trump was running America, it just wasn't going to happen. There would have been no vaccines. He put out a note and said, because ain't nobody giving him no press. So he put out a statement, and he said, if I was president, just remember, he kept telling us to remember that y'all wouldn't have gotten the shot. Y'all would not have gotten the shot.
It was me that did it. I did this. It was all me. Remember that.
Exactly.
But damn, baby, drive speed. Us crazy.
Yeah.
But I don't understand, though. To that, I saw that statement, and I just refused to share it on Twitter because I'm like, if you got rid of the man on social media, why the hell are y'all taking these ridiculous statements and then bringing it to social media for him? But to your point, Rebecca, it's a level of absurdity. Now, I will say this about what Laura Ingraham said, and actually you said it first, Rebecca. The other networks, they have their own agenda too. They do. Like, they've done nothing but give glowing reviews of Joe Biden. Like every New York Times article I see is like, Joe Biden is the man that we need in this moment. No, what we needed was 15 an hour, right? And then they were like, Joe, and Van Jones, like, he's the president that we need right now. But, I mean, dude, you said that about Donald Trump. Tonight, Donald Trump became president of the United States. I'm like, seriously, guy, there is no consistency in journalism, in mainstream media, period. They pick their sides and they pick their narratives, and those narratives that they support are usually ones, or not usually, always one that come at the expense of black people, marginalized groups, and poor people. It's always to the benefit of the top 1%, and this is part and parcel. They're okay with Joe Biden doing just the bare minimum because, well, they don't actually want to do anything more than that, because doing anything more than that probably means they'd have to pay more in taxes. So you're absolutely right when you said that, Rebecca.
You know what's interesting is it's another point, and I don't know if I missed it while you guys were playing it, but I know that he said in his statement, you know, one thing I would like to point out is basically, and this is not verbatim, but this was like, one thing I would like to point out is how we, the people, have lost our trust in the government. But he's like, the government is us, we're the people, so... We're a democracy. So if you guys don't trust us, you don't trust yourselves. I'm like, don't you put this on us. Mm-hmm. Don't you put this on us. This is y'all. This is your folks. This is the government. If we are the government, then why wasn't our voices heard when we were saying we need assistance way back in March of last year. As soon as we passed that 2-week mark, we're like, we're still at home. Some people were already laid off, not knowing when they were going to go back. They thought it was going to be 2 weeks. 2 weeks turned into a month turned into 3 months to a now a year. Mm-hmm. And they have lost their jobs. If we were the voices and the people who run this thing for real and not the government, who is separate from us, then you guys would have definitely given us the financial assistance that we needed. The health care that we needed in this time for free. You know, you would have made sure things were accessible to not just a particular type of community, but for everyone, everyone in this particular moment. Shutdowns would have been real. Mask mandates would have been real. All those things would have been real. And we would have probably been sailing out of this damn pandemic since last year. So that's why I'm like, watch your mouth. And when you say things like that, because we are not, no, the government definitely showed its behind and showed us that we are separate from them. They are more with the political side of things and not the people side of things.
See, I'm not going to blame us for our crappy government in the sense that, oh, if we don't trust them, like that's BS, that's gaslighting. But at a certain extent, I do blame us for tolerating it. Mm-hmm. And I think about the context of it, right? The only way you can actually get away with what this government gets away with, and I don't care who your president is, I don't care who your favorite president is, I don't care if you swear by Joe Biden or you have a shrine to Donald Trump, I don't care. The one thing that's true about this government is that it has broken the American people to the point where we sat back and we watched 527,000 people die because of this government, and we didn't shut this shit all the way down. Right. And that is because we're broken. I mean, tear it down apart at the seams, like rip it. Like there should not be anybody in power. This whole entire regime should be gone. But, you know, you start talking like that. That's when they, you know, that's when the feds start picking up your phone lines and all that kind of, you know, they at your door. That said, though, how broken do we have to? I mean, look at America. Like we are some broken people. Who sits back and watches as the government gives billions of dollars to, I mean, look at Jeff Bezos and Mark Zuckerberg during the pandemic. They made more, all the top 1% made more in the pandemic than what we're getting ready to spend to bail out the entire country, right? You got a handful of people who got so filthy rich during this pandemic while other people sat in food banks and food lines. And that is a result, Rebecca, exactly what you said. It is a result of the fact that this government has broken us down to the point where we actually have to applaud them for saying wear a mask. That's how low our standard is in this country. And the fact is, I think they can get away with more. I think that they could actually push and press us down even more because, I mean, we haven't kicked back yet. So what is it going to take for us to actually hold this government accountable for its culpability? It did this. The United States government, this regime, this both sides of the same coin, they did this to us. 527,000 people are dead because they wanted us to go back to work so that they can make their money. 527,000 people are dead because of the ridiculousness of our politics, right? And even when we had that minor, you know, revolution over the summer with George Floyd, it even got even worse because all the people who talk about revolution, all the people who make money off of socialism and all the people who have all of the subscribers on YouTube and Patreon, they didn't seize the moment that we had right then when the American people were like, okay, we've had enough. But then we got pushback from people who otherwise call themselves revolutionaries. And so my question is there ever going to be enough, or can America literally get away whatever the hell it wants to get away with? That's my question.
I'll take number 2 for 500, Alex. No, but seriously, it's just, you know, what you said is it. I can't argue with it. I definitely agree. We were very stupid in a time. There was two sides of stupid, too. We have the people who were injecting themselves with the bleach.
Oh, my God.
And not wearing the mask and coughing on people on the front lines because they were fighting people, protesting at the hospitals, like, to go get their hairs dyed. This is what, let's never forget those things. Let's never forget those things. So when Donald Trump is putting out those statements to remember, yeah, honey, I will remember all what your folks did to people trying to save lives. And so people are trying to do the right thing. And then we have the other side of it, which is our people who decide in Atlanta to go party and everything because they're bored. And, you know,
you ain't gonna let Atlanta off the hook, are you?
I ain't never gonna let Atlanta off the hook because it's the same side of it. It's the same. They're doing the same thing. But at the end of the day, for all of those who were trying in that time to make sure we're staying home so we can get the financial assistance, so we can do all of this, you know, and because we saw what other countries did and how they got through it, right? But us, we were still in it. So the government could have definitely helped us when we were screaming for help. It didn't have to all go down this way. We could have been out there. We could have been fighting that fight for George Floyd a little harder. I mean, not that we didn't do hard enough, but a lot of us were worried that if we kept going out there, we could potentially die from the police officers or the pandemic. It was so much happening, right? It was just so much happening in that moment. And the government, I do blame, because they sent tanks and things like that to go in the middle of a protest. But over there at the damn terrorist attack at the Capitol,
they act like, oh, I don't know what to do.
And both of these happened during the pandemic. So, like, the government, so kiss my behind, like seriously. So when you make those statements, and I need our president to say these things. This is what I need. I don't want him to say what other presidents have said. I don't want him to be the way other presidents have been. And because we all say that Joe Biden was such a rock star when he was with Barack Obama, with former President Barack Obama. We all seen how he had that fervor and that drive. And now he's just rolling like, this is what we have to do.
You know, that's a different thing.
So that we can get together. And we can. It's not the man that was wearing the shades, you know.
Because it's a couple of years later, though. It's a couple of years later, Rebecca. He ain't as sharp.
Changes. I get it. Oh, aged, old, whatever. But
oh, man.
I need that same fervor. I need one of these presidents to discuss the other pandemic that's happening. I would feel so much better to know that, hey, not for him to sit and say that he's done so much for the African-American community, because he said that, and so did Trump, and so did the people before. And it was like, okay, no, we still out here dying, baby.
Here's the reason they won't, man. And this is, you notice that they're touting this new bill, this $1.9 trillion, and they're saying it's going to cut child poverty by like 42%. And I'm like, I want to see it. Right? Show it to me first. Don't tell me. Let me see it. And if it works, why the hell haven't y'all done that 30 years ago? See, the reason they don't want to actually do, when I say they, I'm talking about them. I'm talking about they. Those folks in Washington, D.C. that are all a part of the same ruling elite, they understand that if they gave the people what we absolutely needed to survive, then the people would have looked at them and said, wait a minute. You mean to tell me the way that you give corporations billions of dollars every year, you could have been giving to the working people of this country, to poor people in this country, to black people in this country? You mean to tell me y'all could have wrote a check and ended poverty a long time ago? And they cannot afford for the American people to realize that this government has always had the capacity to end poverty, to end homelessness, to end hunger, to end, to give everybody Medicare for all, to give everybody an education. This government has always had the capacity to do that. But instead, what do? They let us lose 527,000 people so that they would not reveal the big secret. The big secret that they're keeping from us is that poverty and hunger and all of your struggles are literally a policy choice by this government. And I don't give a damn who your president is. I don't care if it's Barack Obama. I don't care if your private president was John F. Kennedy. All of them know the same thing. They could have ended poverty and homelessness with one bill, but they choose not to.
We all were the shield, the scales fell from my eyes as we started to see during this pandemic, especially in the beginning. Oh my God, like I could have definitely, I could have definitely been working from home this whole time. We were just in this building because they were paying rent for nothing and they just wanted to police us inside of this building. My kids, you know, we could have had them home as well. Like, there's so many things that could have happened in this time that we started realizing yo, we've been living in some kind of scam. Like, they've been having us travel for no damn reason. God knows how far, policing us, reprimanding us for living 2 hours away from a job when we could have been working home from home the whole time. Yep. And it's like, all of this, we could have been getting assistance this whole time. We could have been, the money was available this whole time.
It always has been. It always has been.
Now it makes me look at y'all crazy. Like, it's like, dang, there doesn't have to be poverty in America. But I was speaking to somebody and they were like, well, if there isn't, then how are people going to learn? I'm like, get out of my face.
See, that's the brokenness. That's the other part of it, right? They give us these prosperity gospel. They give us the get rich quick. They give us the pull yourself up by the bootstrap rappers on Clubhouse talking about, what you going to do with your stimmy? I'm going to take my $1,400 and invest in a business. No, the hell you not.
I'm going to get crab legs.
Right.
With the $30 I got left after I paid my bills. Bill.
Right.
So.
Oh, and actually, I'm gonna use my stimulus. Shit. Now, I might use some of my stimulus for actual business because business has needs right now. But for everybody else, like, bro, people in the overdraft by $1,000. Y'all gonna give them $1,400 and expect them to be able to pull. See, this government, it is a scam, Rebecca. It has been a scam for a very long time. All right, we're gonna take a quick break. When we come back,
America is ghetto.
When we come back from this quick break, we're going to be joined by Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes, and we're going to talk about what's happening in his state. We'll be back with more Like It or Not after this.
Shout out to everybody that's taking us out this morning, y'all. Hope y'all are enjoying the show thus far.
Don't say you can't, cause you can. Stop worrying. Try to forgive, cause we all.
Hey, yo, make sure that y'all are hitting that like button. Make sure you hit that like button. Make sure that y'all hit that like button, y'all. It's Like It or Not. Make sure that you comment, share, and subscribe, y'all.
You're trying hard to pursue a dream that's not your own. Don't care about what they expect you to be. Cause when you find out what that truly means, wherever you are, you still feel alone. Always afraid of the unknown.
Go cool, good morning, Purple Rain Hearts, good morning. Yes, Rebecca can really sing, y'all. Rebecca can sing her ass off.
Don't close your eyes, cause we are not.
Chuck, Like It or Not, is not responsible for any broken items in your house that may occur while you are dancing.
Slowly moving towards the light. We first intend. Oh yeah. Don't let them get in your head. Don't let them win. No. So don't go pursue a dream. That's not your role.
Make sure that you become a patron, y'all. As a patron, you'll be able to support the show and become and get ad-free content and exclusive content, y'all. Patreon.com/TheBPDShow. Patreon.com/TheBPDShow. Melanie, good morning, Melanie.
You love it when I get so high and drop that thing so low. Make you sit right here. Now you can't go back home. You love it when I get so high and drop that thing so low.
make you sit right here. Now you can go back home. You love it when I get so high and drop that thing so low. Make you sit right here. Now you can go back home. You love it when I get so high and drop that thing so low. Make you sit right here.
Rebecca,
now you can go back home.
I'm banked up and I'm banked up and I'm satisfied.
They knees ain't the same.
I'm banked up and I'm satisfied. You bend it down and you poke it up and you elevated, you elevated.
I came over, I ain't sober, I'm still drunk, that's hangover. Might run it back.
The name of the song is called Sober Thoughts, but it's like it spells sober though.
For that understressing, yeah. Over him now you underdressing. Call me up and I come finessing like
a silhouette.
Do what it don't. Baby, you a queen, you can move how you want. You was rocking with me when I couldn't stay afloat. They ain't never saying nothing, wavy to a boat. Like eyes up, look at me now. I'm
right.
The camera, time for action. Split the legs just like a fraction. Tuck the napkin, time for snacking. You a mother meal. Tell me that it's mine, baby. Tell me that it's real. Hit it to the max. Well, tell me how it feel. It's gonna be a minute, cause I'm in it for the thrill. Make her feel like heaven. She gon' put me in the wheel. And willingly, I wanna do anything she wanna do. I ain't even wanna boo, but this is what the karma
do. Y'all are terrible people.
I love it when I get so high and drop that thing so
yeah. Y'all, welcome back to the screen. Y'all, welcome back to the screen. Benjamin Dixon, y'all.
Oh, man. That song gets people in trouble, James. I gotta screen some songs before we go to the next segment. Welcome back to Like It or Not, where we're free to tell the truth, and I care who doesn't like it. Joining me now is Mandela Barnes. He is the Lieutenant Governor of Wisconsin and has been since 2019. As a former state representative and Milwaukee local, Lieutenant Governor Barnes has been involved with Wisconsin politics for much of his career. Lieutenant Governor, thank you so much for joining me. How are you this morning?
Hey, my man, I'm doing real good. It's good to see you again. Haven't seen you since like 2017, so it's good to have a chance to speak with you.
It is our pleasure, man. And since then, like, you have been consistently and persistently working in politics there in Wisconsin. And you've, first and foremost, congratulations on achieving the office of Lieutenant Governor. That's no small feat. And we want to salute you for that. But in your time as Lieutenant Governor, you have had to navigate this pandemic. And as well as the politics around voter suppression, none of that has stopped simply because of the pandemic. Tell us the status of your state with regards to the pandemic, as well as the same voter suppression efforts that we've seen spreading across the state of Georgia.
To be honest, man, it's gotten a lot worse. I think about the pandemic and how it's primarily, or I guess I should say disproportionately impacted communities of color, brown and black communities who bore the brunt of this virus, our Native American communities as well. And so these issues that we've had before as far as health inequity have existed for a long time, but the pandemic just sort of exposed it to a lot of people. And it's still unfortunate because a lot of the people who saw this to be new still chose not to respond. And then with voter suppression, people had to be able to safely cast a ballot. And that meant more mail-in voting than normal here in the state of Wisconsin. And now they want to try to restrict mail-in voting. So it's like the pandemic showed a lot of flaws and inequities that we had as far as healthcare and democracy itself. And instead of trying to fix those problems, making life a little bit easier for people in this state, our Republican-controlled legislature, who has that majority by way of gerrymandering, decides that they want to still continue to try to make life harder for people. I mean, it's a shame. And we're talking about people who are losing their lives and people who stand to potentially lose their rights. And we have to fight back against this as much as we possibly can. This is a fight we cannot give up because there is no alternative.
Right, right. You tweeted something the other day that I want to bring up on the screen here. You said, before the pandemic, income inequality in Wisconsin was at its highest point since the Great Depression. COVID-19 did not make things better. The American Rescue Plan is an all-important first step, but next, we need big structural change. Tell me about that big structural change that you feel like we obviously need.
Yeah, absolutely. So here in Wisconsin, that was based on a either 2017 or 2018 report, but obviously between 18 and 2019, things didn't change that drastically as far as income inequality in our state. But with the pandemic, that has made things much worse. Billionaire wealth has increased over $1.5 trillion over the course of this pandemic, while families are struggling. People are out of work. People are in debt. You talked about just before I came on about people being overdrafted in the thousands. This is the reality for so many people, while at the same time, we have billionaires and multimillionaires who continue to increase their worth. So we have to take bold action, man, to reduce the disparities. And I see in Washington State, they just passed the capital gains tax. Like they tried multiple legislative sessions to get that done. Senator Warren and her wealth tax bill is an important first step to shift the balance, man. If we don't get money in the pockets of hardworking people, or unfortunately now people who are out of work, this economy is going to go to hell in a handbag real quick. And I don't think people understand how pervasive, and I don't think people understand what happens when inequality grows at this rate, when people cannot afford basic necessities and people cannot afford to live, while at the same time, you got people who have money that they will never, ever spend. Greed is going to be the demise of this entire society. And we have to stop it right now, man. We can't let Amazon take over the entire world while people are still struggling to put food on the table.
Yeah, no, you're hitting on the exact things that we talk about, right? The fact that, you said it, greed will be the downfall of our entire society and yet our entire civilization. I wonder then, as you have matriculated up into the spaces of power in your state, there seems to be a veil where people go into office and it's like we almost lose track of them, or they get sucked into the abyss of power, or to the black hole of just nothingness, and we don't get any results. I wonder, as a person who's now on the inside of your state system at the highest level, what happens? I mean, I know we have the lobbyists. I know we have the opposition party. And I know we have people who actually think greed is good. But what happens to our troops when we send them there and we put them in power, and it seems as though like they become all of a sudden outside of power, they had all the stuff to say that was right, but inside of power, it seems like that power diminishes, or that fight against greed and individualism diminishes. From your perspective, what happens when you come from the outside to the inside?
Man, that's what happens when you elect people without a mission. And, you know, I showed up, and I even when I was a state rep, and to this point now, I don't think there's a difference in my approach to things. And I ran for state representative because I was an organizer with an interfaith group. And our issues were jobs and economic development, education, immigration reform, and treatment instead of prison. I knew what I was going there to do. And you got so many people who run for office who are making it up as they go. People who run for multiple offices at the same time, being a completely different candidate for each office they've ever run for. And you got people who just want to show up for the vanity of it all, people who've like maybe amassed an amount of wealth and figure that this is the next logical step in their career, but show up and have no idea what's actually going on, man. I am still talking about the same exact things I've been talking about 10 years ago. I am still friends with the same people I was friends with 10 years ago, and I'm still in the same fights with the people I was with 10 years ago. Being in this position, I'm proud that we have pushed and moved on those issues that I've been talking about since 10 years ago. Like the fact that, you know, our state was one of the ones that spent more in general purpose revenue on the Department of Corrections and the UW system. And this budget that the governor just put out finally shifts that paradigm. And we are at the end of the biennium going to be investing more in our UW system, because we have to prioritize education over incarceration if we ever want to get this thing right. We are leading with equity. We have racial equity plans in this state right now, internally within state government, as far as hiring practices in terms of every office. My office had to do a racial justice training. I even had to do it myself. Because we have to lead by example. Wisconsin has some of the worst disparities along racial lines, and we have to be committed to fixing that. And so I'm proud of the work that we've been able to do, because I didn't just figure this stuff out in the middle of a campaign just to get some applause at a debate or a rally. I talked about the things that I was actually working on and saw elected office as a continuation of that work.
I want to share one more tweet. This one is from a reporter, Gabby Bachara, and she's actually quoting you where you said the following. You said, quote, "We have an opportunity to get something done." And then she gave context. "Starting now, the Wisconsin Six will fast for 22 days to spark action for climate change. The hope is to keep climate justice in Governor Evers' budget and expand on it." Tell me about that Wisconsin Six and the 22-day fast for climate change action.
Hey, man, anytime somebody says we're going to bring up a tweet, get a little bit nervous. sometimes I get the call from the governor's office. So about this tweet.
Yeah.
So that was about a group from Kenosha. Actually, Justin Blake, who's the uncle of Jacob Blake, who was shot by police, is one of the members. And he called me up one day. He said, You know, this doesn't stop. We still have so many issues we have to continue to work on. We support what you're doing. I chaired the governor's task force on climate change. We brought together 32 people from across the state, different professions, and we released the most ambitious climate change action plan the state has ever seen. It was 55 recommendations that span 9 different sectors, the economy, the environment, obviously, agriculture, education, and a number of other issues for bold climate action. And they are marching and they are fasting in support of their own climate policies. But many of them are climate related policies that will be or that are currently in the governor's budget. Just trying to bring attention to the issue. You know, it's that inside outside strategy. You talk about people going away. And I've always seen being elected office is us making sure that we are tethered, that we still have that inside outside strategy, because with our legislature, it's very difficult to get important things done. But we have people organizing on the outside, building public consensus, shifting public opinion. That is how we move policy. That is how we move an agenda.
One last thing that I kind of want to talk to you about. Ron Johnson. The Republican senator from Wisconsin is hinting that he may not run for re-election. I have been following your work for some time. And that Senate seat is opening up in 2022, right around the corner. We're in this cycle. He made a vow to only serve 2 terms in the Senate. And so it looks like he may not run. Are you going to run?
So what I will say is that whatever Ron Johnson does won't dictate my decision. You know, a number of people have, talked to me about it, brought this to me. And it's something I've honestly thought about. But we do have a whole lot of work that I was talking about earlier. I want to see this budget get passed. I want to see some of the higher priority items get a chance to be talked about in a way that they won't be talked about. I was elected to do a job. I need to do this job first because that's the important thing to do. And if I do decide to run, I will want a potential candidacy to be, determined on the work that I have with the chance that I was given. So I don't have a final decision on that, but it's something that I've certainly considered, and I'm very grateful for the amount of people who've reached out about it, because this is something that we have to get right, and not just any candidate is going to win that race. We need to lead with a bold vision, and people have to have proven themselves if they want to be able to get the support of the public.
Yeah. Oh, man. That's kind of response is the kind of response you get from a seasoned politician who's ready to run. So tell everybody how they can get up with you and how they can support you and what you're doing and where they can find more about you.
Yeah, man. I guess Twitter is the easiest. The Other Mandela. And that is that's the easiest way to find me. And that's how we've stayed in touch. So if people want to follow along and see what happens next, The Other Mandela is the way to find me.
Hey, brother, it's always a pleasure. Glad to reconnect with you and hoping to support you as you continue to fight for the same things today that I saw you fighting for when I first met you. So thanks so much for joining us this morning.
Hey, you too, man. I hope you do this again.
Absolutely. James, take us to a quick break. When we come back, we have more Like It or Not right after this.
All right. Shout out to everybody. Lieutenant Governor Barnes, thank you so much for joining us this morning. We greatly appreciate you. Y'all, it's Friday.
I could really use a
shade. Should I say?
Yeah. Everybody smoking all the greenery. Yeah.
Make sure that y'all are hitting that like button, y'all. Make sure that you're hitting that like button wherever you're streaming from. Make sure it's a like button. Comment, subscribe, share, 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 please.
Still fly, let's go. It could all be worse. I could be a hater like you. It could all be worse. Pills to make the man, but that poison's gonna chew you. From the inside out. So right now, say it with your chest now. Say it with your chest now.
I'm young, I'm free. Can't nobody take me here and now. It's my time to ride it out.
It's my time, it's my time.
It's my time to ride it out. I'm young, I'm free. Can't nobody take me here and now. It's my time to ride it out.
It's my time.
Right, church, wrong pew, good morning.
It's my time to ride it out.
It's my time, it's my time.
Cheers to all the haters, cause you proved to me that rising to the top was my destiny. And you can see whatever from behind me, but I'm still fly, I'm still fly, I know. I'm still fly, I'm still fly, let's go.
Yo, make sure that you become a patron of the show. Patreon.com/TheBPDShow. Patreon.com/TheBPDShow.
But that boy that's gonna kill you. From the inside out, it's time to say it with your chest now. Say it with your chest now.
I'm young,
Black
I'm
Dragon,
free.
Good morning.
Can't nobody take me here and now. It's my time to ride it out.
It's my time, it's my time.
It's my time to ride it. I'm young, I'm free. Can't nobody take me here and now. It's my time.
Purple Rain Hearts, right. Purple Rain Hearts say, I'm going
to
be even more fly with that stimulus, okay? Yeah, run me my money. Where the money reside, where the money reside.
If you're on the bus, say yeah.
Joy and Tarot, good morning.
If you're on the train, say yeah.
Yeah.
If you got a walk, say yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody's going somewhere.
Yeah.
Young or old, I really don't care.
Yeah.
Life has never really been fair.
Yeah.
So put your fist up in the air.
Yeah.
Say
appreciate that super chat, Gail. Thank you so much.
Here and now, it's my time to ride it out.
Hey, when he said, put your fist up in the air.
It's my time to ride it out.
Yeah, that's my part.
Yeah. I like this one.
Yeah, this is the pride favorite.
Well, we're free to tell the truth. Oh, no, that's your part.
I'm not care if he doesn't like it. Shout out to the other Mandela. Like, that's a dope brother, man. He's been a real consistent force in these social media spaces and ran. And, you know, he got back up again and ran again. And now he's lieutenant governor of an entire state at a young age. Like, and it sounds like he's going to remain pretty consistent in what he's fighting for. And that's rare. So shout out to him on that.
Yeah, people be giving up. It'd be hard out here. Like, you know, I ain't about to keep fighting for y'all. I'm tired.
Lord Jesus, let me tell you, it is hard to keep fighting on behalf of people who sometimes can be just as ignorant as the people you fighting against. So I get it. I get it. And the fact that he's still consistent.
Yeah.
Blessed be the name. All right, Rebecca, what you
got? So yeah, that just took me through. Like, dang, I'd be ready to give up a lot of times, but I'm here and I'm still rocking with y'all. So Sharon Osbourne, as we know, but let me start here.
Okay.
We know that the recent interview with Oprah, Meghan Markle, and Prince Harry all together has caused a royal debacle of royal ponderosa during this pandemic. And so everybody has had their opinions on it. Sharon Osbourne shared her recent opinion on it. And I wanted you to take a look at how her co-host responded to her. Let's take a look.
I support him for his freedom of speech, and he's my friend. I'm not racist. Neither is Piers racist, and I hate the fact of even saying I'm not racist. I'm the last person in the world who's racist.
And I've never seen anything come out of you other than, if I don't know, I'm willing to learn. If it comes off a certain way, I stand corrected.
That means they're the most racist person. Yeah,
what would you say to people who may feel that you, while you're standing by your friend, it appears that you give validation or safe haven to something that he has uttered that is racist? Even if you don't agree.
I don't think you're racist, just to say that super plainly. I don't think you're racist. But I think if people know you're not racist, they would want you to stand up to your friend who has done racist things, who has been sexist in the coverage of Meghan. I think that's where it's coming from.
I feel even I'm about to be put in the electric chair because I have a friend who many people think is a racist, so that makes me a racist. And for me, at 68 years of age, to have to turn around and say, I ain't racist. What's it got to do with me? How can I be racist about anybody?
Oh, man.
How can I be racist about anybody or anything in my life? How can I?
We'll be right back. We have more topics, so don't go away. But I want you to hear from me.
I will ask you again, Cheryl. Yes. I've been asking you during the break. Right. I am asking you again. And don't try and cry, because if anyone should be crying, it should be me. Educate me. Tell me when you have heard him say racist things.
It is not the exact words of racism. It's the implication and the reaction to it. To not want to address that because she is a black woman and to try to dismiss it or to make it seem less than what it is. That's what makes it racist.
Jesus.
So for me, it would have been definitely, you know, for me, like, listen, Cheryl, baby.
Rebecca's pulling up her braids. She ready to fight.
Here we go.
Cheryl, you could
She's taking off her earring.
Cheryl, you could have definitely.
Girl, I got the Vaseline.
Right, sharing the way, you know, that you wanted to, but me, sweetie, on the other hand, I'm just not. No, seriously, though.
What's it say? It's a problem?
Seriously, though, I do not like the fact that Cheryl, I know it's a talk show for them, I do, and I know that Cheryl wanted to make sure that she wasn't viewed as the angry woman who should have educated Sharon in that moment.
Yep.
And then here's my thing about it. Sharon wanted to make sure that it was only her tears that were viewed as something that people can empathize with. Those white guilt tears. Mm. And so even though Cheryl was getting emotional, like, girl, I'm trying not to make you look crazy and you got me out here looking crazy. And I actually love you as a person.
Yeah.
And I'm trying my best. Not because for me, if I look crazy, I'm going to get attacked. But now
I'm not a racist.
But and then she said, but I'm not a racist. And she's like, educate me. Tell me. First of all, Heffa, the one thing I'm not going to do. The one thing I'm not going to do is educate you on and nothing, because that is not my responsibility.
Right.
And I had to learn that myself in this space. I had to learn that myself. I do give you guys tips and tidbits and I tell y'all, please don't. But you don't for me to educate you. Don't ever yell at me and tell me to educate you, especially as a white woman. I will smack.
Educate
that,
me.
I'll smack that accent out of your mouth. Don't. And I say
talking
that with
straight
every,
English, regular English.
I say that with the most. The
oh
most disrespect, because watching that to me was as if she was talking to somebody, who was more inferior than her. What, like my friend Piers Morgan doesn't say anything racist, and I don't have a racist bone in my body.
How
but you're
I
yelling
racist?
At this black woman here in this space, and that's what bothered me the most. What's funny is she ended up giving a statement, because that's what all these people have who have been supporting Piers Morgan or the other side, the Royals and things like that. They have now been, like, 2 days later, they're saying, this is how they're all starting it, after much reflection. And she put that out yesterday. After much reflection, I realized that my words, or I've overstated, you know, what I was trying to say. I wasn't able to articulate what I was trying to say. But Cheryl, baby, mm-hmm. I love how poised you were. But I'm tired of y'all in this space, in these spaces, expecting us to be so poised when we're being disrespected by white women. That woman was screaming, yelling at her, telling her that her feelings don't matter as a black woman. And saying to her that my feelings as a white woman matter more. I don't care of anything that you're trying to say when it comes to Piers Morgan speaking against this woman and her color and defending these royals and being mad at that he was rejected. And then she said, tell me when he said anything that was racist. And sweetie, we could go through a whole book. Cheryl was like, it's the implication. She just, and Cheryl made it nice and sweet and broke that down for her. But here's the thing. Sharon wasn't going to take that. She still was like, tell me, you ain't telling me nothing. You ain't telling me nothing. Literally yelling and owning the room as Cheryl had to stay calm. And I'm tired of y'all expecting us black women to stay calm in these environments. And we have to, because we don't want to look crazy. We don't want to lose our jobs because we done drag this heifer across the room. We don't want to lose our jobs because we told her what's up the way that she's in the same manner that she's telling us. But when it comes from a black woman, it's a problem.
Let me, the Cheryl's blood pressure in that clip, I guaranteed you, went from something stable to like she might need to go see a doctor, right? Because the amount of energy that it takes for us to have to coddle whiteness in its greatest and most arrogant form, where she's literally shedding white tears.
I'm 68 years old. How could I possibly be a racist?
Well, you're old enough to have been back there during the civil rights.
She has been a racist too.
Like, let's be clear, right? But then for Cheryl to have to compartmentalize all of her righteous indignation. See, this is why black people be dying so young. Because if we really gave y'all what y'all deserve, shit, we'd all be in jail right now. But instead, we internalize it. And a lot of people were giving, like Rebecca, like you said, a lot of people were giving Cheryl her kudos for being professional and handling it so eloquently. But I'm sorry, it's time out for handling this stuff eloquently, because y'all ain't learning. Y'all don't want to learn. You expect us to teach you. When you got Google, you can learn anything you need to learn. But the fact is that she has no interest in actually learning about how her friend is a racist. She needed that moment to be about her. And her tears, and then denied Cheryl. When she denied Cheryl her emotions and said, don't you start crying right now. And yet, and that's exactly what she was doing. She should be. She better be glad Cheryl ain't take that wig off and drag her half across the stage.
Hit her with the wig. Hit her with the wig. It's like, right in the face. It's crazy. Wipe them white guilt tears right off her face with the wig. Because, and it shows you right here, because Sharon Osbourne has actually been in the media years ago for saying racist things. And so her and her husband. So these are the people who love the royals and they're racist themselves. So, you know, just because you come from England does not mean your tears cry differently here. Those doesn't mean that your racism is different. You're the same racist, your same white race. You're a Karen. Sharon.
In that moment, she was demonstrating the racism that's inside of her. Right. Yes. She was using her power on that stage, on that platform, her position on the show, and her whiteness to dominate Cheryl's humanity. I'm sorry, that has got to be one of the greatest examples. Racism ain't just calling us the N-word, y'all. Racism isn't just, you know, whatever you think that is like a cliche form of racism. Racism is right there in that moment where she decided that she was going to leverage her power as a white woman to infringe on other people's humanity because she needed that moment to be about her. So
telling her that, telling a black woman that your voice doesn't matter, and then yelling at her to educate me, and then tell her that her emotions don't matter, when her emotions were literally trying to save Sharon's image on air.
Oh, man.
And then with her bald-headed dog. Everything bald-headed, black folks, when they mad at it.
Bald-headed ass dog.
But it's just white privilege everywhere here.
Oh, my God.
When you first said that the dog was up there, I'm just like, y'all know why that dog up there? Come on.
Right.
She got more respect for her dog.
The Caucasity of it all.
Bro, she had more respect for her damn dog in that moment than she had for Cheryl.
Yep. And then the girl next to her, was trying to feed into it too. I know you're not a racist. I don't think you're a racist. I don't think. Heffa, shut up. Because now the blackest girl, now the blackest woman on stage has to be like nice too. And she's trying to really be sweet and nice about it. Because if the blackest woman on stage is going to say something, everybody's going to be like, here she goes, an angry black woman.
But you know what? But check me out. I want to extend a license to every black person in this country. Be an angry black woman. Be an angry black man. Be an angry non-gender conforming black person. Because you know what? If you internalize it, it's going to kill you. Make them pay. Make them carry the burden of their ignorance and their stupidity and their unwillingness to Google and look themselves in the mirror and realize, oh yeah, I have been part and parcel with the system. We've been internalizing it so long. And it's been literally killing us. You think black folks, we ain't just got high blood pressure because we like ham hocks and collard greens and all whatever. We got high blood pressure because we've been carrying y'all infantile brains when it comes to racism. And all the time, we got to suck it up because we don't want people to think rank. I'm angry. I'm angry enough to tear this entire country to the ground. Angry.
Yeah.
Shit. Okay. Because anyway, that's work right now. That's all work. Angry black man.
I'm going to give I would give the most uncomfortable transition that I've ever given. Coming up is one of my good white friends. He's dope. He's dope on the microphone, and he's dope with his reporting. We'll be joined by David Sirota after we come back from this break. More like it or not, after this.
I swear I don't like them two people on the screen with me. They get on my nerves. Right.
We've been fighting every day now.
Y'all are dumb.
Yeah, I think I need to break out. I don't know what to say now. Cause everything I do just don't feel right. You be going through my phone like trying to find something while you don't trust me. I got this.
Levi, good morning, good morning, good morning, everybody. Make sure that you hit that like button, y'all. Hit that like button. Comment, subscribe, share, all that good stuff, man. Shout out to everybody that's on all our streams. Streaming from everywhere. Yeah.
You say you're sorry. It's too late. I don't wanna hear no more excuses. It's alright. See, I'ma walk away cause I'd rather be alone now. It's alright. Girl, you better recognize. Hey, I got it.
Mara, good morning, Mara.
Baby, you don't wanna act right. Give your chance, set the chance, and you blew it. All you wanna do is pick a fight. And I had to be the bigger man. Always seeing what I don't do. Give you everything I had, still it ain't enough. I got this feeling I'll be much better on my own. There you go. With apologies, it's alright. You don't mean it. I don't wanna try no more.
Sugar Booger, good morning, Sugar Booger.
I don't wanna hear you say you're sorry. It's too late. I don't wanna hear no more excuses. It's alright.
Gavin, what's that? One dub plate?
Cause I'd rather be alone now. It's alright. Girl, you better recognize. Yeah, I got it. I'm
calling you up at 2 in the morning, but you don't wanna talk, you don't wanna bother. Yeah, so I took another shot.
Anna Hart, you are so welcome, ma'am. Anna Hart, you are quite welcome.
I don't wanna be your friend, I want something real. Maybe if I stay the night, you could feel the same. And maybe if you treat me right, we can rearrange. But I'm not even gonna try.
Latif, we appreciate that super chat, Latif, man. I appreciate that.
You got me on my knees. I don't need no roses on my bed.
I could pull you closer to me, babe. Ain't nobody touch me like you can. I just need some closure, a little closure from you. Just tear me apart when I know you don't want me. Cause I've been going fast and you wanna go slowly.
Chris Shaw, I appreciate that.
I'm just wasting time. Tell me how you feel.
Mama, don't dance too hard now. You know your knees bad, mama.
Friend, I want something real. Maybe if I stay the night, you could feel the same. And maybe if you treat me right, we could rearrange. But I'm not even gonna try if you don't wanna stay. So how's it gonna be? You got me on my knees. I don't need no roses.
Purple Rain Hearts, this is Dean's.
I could pull you closer to me, babe.
This is Dean's featuring Rebel Day called A Little Closure.
I just need some closure, a little closure. I don't need no roses on my bed. If I could pull you closer to me, babe, ain't nobody touch.
Why I call my mama out? Because she knows she not my mom. Love you, mama.
Closure, a little closure from you. A little closure.
Look at you. Look at my overlook, which way it is. Look at this. I love this. But Shirley Chisholm, right, guys? I want to make sure that we discuss her because it is Women's Month. We're still celebrating women all month. And it would be a disservice if I didn't speak about her. And the one reason why I also want to speak about her is because last week we had two amazing guests out of, like, we had a lineup of great guests. But last week we had both Senator Nina Turner and Isaiah James on our show, Like It or Not, who both mentioned the historic Shirley Chisholm while they were on. They both cited her as a source of inspiration to themselves, but also Isaiah James is running to fill the 9th Congressional District in New York, which Ms. Chisholm represented for 7 terms. One of our producers mentioned in Slack that this was the first time that they had really heard about Ms. Chisholm. That means we ain't doing our job here in America. That means Black folks ain't doing what they need to do. If this is the first time, okay, that people are hearing about her. So we got to do better. So in honor of Women's History Month, let's talk a little bit about her. So her motto and her title for her autobiography was Unbossed and Unbought, which a lot of people do utilize. One person, Senator Nina Turner, who has that same fervor. So with hello, somebody. And Shirley was born in 1924. She passed away in 2005. In 1964, she became the second African-American in the New York State Legislature and was the first African-American woman in Congress, 1968, and the first woman, an African-American, okay, the first woman and Black person to seek the nomination for president from either the Democratic or Republican Party. Here's Shirley, here's Ms. Chisholm speaking on the importance of activism.
Government only responds to unyielding pressures when the citizens of the nation begin to indicate clearly, not by rhetoric, not by resolutions, but by activism, that something has to be done.
So activism, she always spoke about something having to be done, standing in place, doing the work. And this is her advice to young people.
Get a good education. Follow your mind. Follow the dictates of your conscience. Do what you think and feel has to be done in order for you to achieve. And you'll be able to succeed.
I really believe that.
Do you think that young African Americans feel hopeful?
No.
No. Do you think that is self-defeating if you are hopeless?
Yes.
So what can be done to make young people see that they can be hopeful?
All you can do, you can constantly lecture to them and constantly answer their queries and their questions about things. But so much of it has to do with the kind of environment in which they're reared.
Yes. Then, of course, young people are bombarded with negative images, from different forms
That's
of media.
Right.
So that those repetitive messages perhaps are making them feel hopeless or defining them.
That's right.
That they believe these definitions.
Yes.
What can be done, do you think? What can be done to counter these repetitive negative messages and images?
I still say that basically you always have to go back to the environment in which they're being reared. You always have to go back to that. I know.
And
certainly, Chisholm
said something very important, and that's always going back to the environment that these young folks are being raised in. And if we look at today, we can talk about the same thing with the environments that a lot of young folk and young people of color are being raised in, which does have an impact on how they move and why they protest. And why they fight. So here, finally, I want to play this clip from Shirley's presidential announcement speech in 1975.
Fellow Americans, we have looked in vain for the courage, the spirit, the character, and the words to lift us, to bring out the best in us, to rekindle in each of us our faith in the American dream. Yet all that we have received in return is just another smooth exercise in political manipulation, deceit and deception, callousness and indifference to our individual problems, and the disgusting playing of divisive politics, pitting the young against the old, labor against management, North against South, black against white. American people. I believe that we are smart enough to correct our mistakes. I believe we are intelligent enough to recognize the talent, energy, and dedication which all Americans, including women and minorities, have to offer. I know from my travels to the cities and small towns of America that we have a vast potential which can and must be put to constructive use in getting this great nation together. I know that millions of Americans from all walks of life agree with me that leadership does not mean putting the ear to the ground to follow public opinion, but to have the vision of what is necessary and the courage to make it possible. I would remind all Americans at this hour of the words of Abraham Lincoln, "A house divided cannot stand."
Shirley Chisholm, we pay homage to you. We thank you. We walk in your light. We walk in your words. And we will be unbossed and unbothered.
Rebecca, that was that was powerful. That sister, one thing, the first thing that came to mind as I watched was that when people say, "I am not my ancestors," you know, saying like that we today are like badder or we'll fight first or whatever, I think we got it backwards. We aren't our ancestors, because I don't know that we got the heart that Shirley Chisholm had to do this, to run at that level at the height of racism and Jim Crow, right before the inflection point where we started to move away from it just a little bit. She had the temerity to jump out there and just be a boss and not care and just be as fearless. Like, I don't know that we have people as fearless today as Shirley Chisholm. Right. I don't know that we have people as fearless today as any number of people who were able to fight those fights at the height of slavery, Jim Crow, and segregation. So salute to Shirley Chisholm. I want to be like my ancestors.
Yeah. Yes. And I want to be like mine as well. Definitely. I want to definitely shoot that. Now, I said unbossed and unbothered. That's my remix of it. It's unbossed and unbot. Now, yeah. Don't get that and say, oh, that's not what it was. It wasn't. That was my remix. What do you have to say about it, Bubba? I know that you, when you're watching that, you felt that same energy. And Ben, you said something very big, too. I mean, I wish I was my ancestors. I wish I could fight the way they did. But some days I ain't got it. I'm tired.
Right. And thank you for doing this, Rebecca. That was absolutely amazing and empowering. Because like you said, and what Ben said, it's the truth. I would rather be my ancestors. Because think about all they had to endure. And you think about what we're going through now. Yes, it's bad. Mm. But think about what they went through. Think about being on a boat, coming over here from a foreign to coming to a foreign country where your family's behind you.
That's my
parents'
story.
Okay. So, hey, you see what I'm saying, Rebecca? All right. So that's
that's courage.
Yeah. Yeah, that's how the people shine on that right there, y'all.
Yeah. And it's a lot. And sorry, go ahead, Ben.
No, I'm just thinking like, think what it took for Harriet Tubman. Yeah. Like, I hold my word, I hold my tongue. Because I know some of the stuff that we could say going to get us a knock on the door by the feds, right? Imagine being at the height of slavery and not giving a damn. And just saying what's right is right, what's wrong is wrong. And putting your life on the line. We're fighting against an empire right now. Yeah. No, it's cute fighting. Like, we fight on social media. And people out in the streets for sure are putting out some real fights, right?
Virtual fights.
I dream of being as brave as my ancestors, because we're not them, but we should aspire to be. So shout out to you, Rebecca, for putting that together for us.
And you know, what's interesting is she, like you mentioned, Bubba, she even comes from a Caribbean background in the middle of, you know, New York, Brooklyn, you know what I mean? In those areas where it was rugged and a lot of Caribbean folks were. So she, and then her being a woman, a Black woman in that particular time, there were so many disadvantages against her, but she decided to step up in a place, in an area that no one has ever stepped into. And she still did it while a lot of people told her no. You know what I mean? And she's like, if there's no room for me at the table, I'm going to go ahead and bring a folding chair. Like, that was, those words came from her. This is who we've been quoting and running around with. So the fact that, and I've covered her, before, but the fact that, and I said it in my last coverage of her, we don't know her like that. Like, why don't we say her name when we say Beyoncé's and we say Michelle Obama's, who are great, great leaders and role models. But this woman, Shirley, come on now. Like, Shirley Chisholm, she is a big deal. And when you see Black women in politics, you got to look back and be like, Shirley, Fannie Lou, like, go find out who those women were. Because of them, we have our Nina Turner. Because of them, we have all of our Michelle Obama. Because of them, we even have our Kamala Harris. So be grateful. Go check them out. If you're watching right now, white folks, I just educated you. I just educated
on
you.
On our team. what's that? I can't even remember. Osborne. We did. There you go. That's the most education you're going to get from us. You, on the other hand, you got Google, www.google.com. You can find out all the different ways that you have been part and parcel of this system. But
Google, cut the check.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of Black people out there don't know, that millennials like me, who don't say her name because they don't really know about her. So we got to make sure.
And
we
that's
do
fine.
Our
you
job.
Know what? And that's it's okay, because every generation. What's funny though is like when people are like, oh, you don't know this person. Nah, bro. I'm just barely learning the stuff that this raggedy school system is teaching me. Right. So give people the space to actually grow and learn, right? It's
white
one thing
too?
To not know. Well, you know, they can do it on their own. But I'm talking about us. I'm
saying, look, we got a different kind of sensitivity for our folks. Listen, because y'all taught us all this white education. Now we gotta reteach, unlearn some things.
It's like to water it down a little bit. I'm not so serious, but it's like when people don't know references to a common Black movie that we've all seen.
Like me.
Yes, like you, Rebecca.
Growing
like
up in a Haitian household, it was not easy for me to balance all these cultures.
but we got to give you space and grace. Now, once we teach it to you, you better not forget it, right? Yeah. So are those Bugle Boy jeans you're wearing?
Yeah.
She said, oh, yeah.
You guys taught me this. And I know the song. That's the thing. I know the song.
Ooh, Rebecca, you got a C minus right there. That's okay.
Yeah.
So listen, I think I messed up with David Sirota. I think we got our wires crossed on the time. He was expecting to come in at 10:30. And so we're trying to work that out. We may have to reschedule him. I've been talking with him now, reschedule him for another week. But if nothing else, man, this has been a really thorough and this show blessed me today, Rebecca. That last segment really touched me.
Yeah, and I'm going to do it every week. So every Friday, be expecting me to talk about some Black woman in history, new, old, whatever. We're going to, will be delivering some Black goodness in the, in the form of women's power. And it's going to be a Black woman. And I want all of you guys to understand and know who these are. You know, when we know Mona Lisa, this is the moment where I think these Fridays will be a space for us to remove the lies my teacher taught me, add some realness and some understanding to it. And I'm excited about it, and I'm grateful that we get to do it right here, me not being placed in the box, you know?
Yes.
It's good.
Yeah.
Right.
All right. That said, let me just check my messages one more time. Okay, so we're going to reschedule. That said, what else you got? Anything else? We got a whole 9 minutes. We're normally overtime.
Oh, ooh, I know. Light is still on. That means that the Lord wants me to speak. I didn't even change my battery.
Ben challenged me yesterday. Can I play that? I got something for y'all. Let me.
What you got? You got a mix? Yeah. You got a mix? It's Friday.
Oh my God, play it.
Y'all ready? Like, here you go.
Here you go. Oh man, you taking it back right there, bro.
7 a.m. waking up in the morning. Gotta go downstairs.
Hey.
Gotta have serious.
He did it!
Hey! Jay! Is that the Yin Yang Twins and Rebecca Black?
How you like it, Daddy? How you like it? No, Petey Pablo.
My type?
Oh, I hear that.
It's originally Petey Pablo, baby.
Yeah, Petey Pablo for sure.
Ben did ask, that...
it's Friday. I wanted to hear Rebecca Black.
Of a mix, Rebecca Black.
I didn't know if he could... I always challenge him. He always does it. My favorite mix still to this day, though, is Megan Thee Stallion going into Kirk Franklin. Like, that's what's up, man. Now, for cultural reference, folks, like we are talking about, how long has that song been out? That was like the first viral song back in 1990. I don't know how long it was. But
no, anyway. It was like in 2000 like or something.
2002 or 3 maybe?
Yeah. Talking about 1990. Yeah.
And now it was a long time.
Right. Well, like, no, bro, we were still in school.
Well, we're close. 2003 is closer to 1999 than it is today. We get old. Rebecca, if you remember that song when it came out. You old.
Yeah. No, I'm not old.
Yeah,
but you
Rebecca.
Are. We're 10 years apart and we're still in the millennial. We're still in the millennial box together, but that's 10 years. That's separate.
Yeah, no, it's all right. I'm an elder millennial.
Yeah.
But what y'all are in that uncomfortable space where you are transitioning now to being the old folks, and like Generation Z is like, it used to be all the
Generation Z is the generation, and I hate that you brought this up because I do something old lady, but Generation Z has nothing that is really their own. They want to be 90 so bad. They want to wear they're wearing our clothes.
I like Generation Z.
I didn't say I don't like them, but I'm saying we literally created a pathway for them, like a lot of people have. Like, but what I'm saying is,
wait a minute, Generation X created that pathway for all of y'all.
Hey,
thanks.
I get to go back and forth
so y'all can run.
I'm literally both.
But you like 2 years in Generation X though, so stop playing with yourself. Anywho,
don't matter.
It don't count, sweetie. But honestly, I was talking with somebody at the nail salon. And what happened was,
did they have on masks?
Everybody had on masks. It was just me and my it was me and my nail tag, and there was
go ahead, Rebecca.
I go to a, I don't go to a nail salon. Salon, it's a suite where it's just you and the person.
Oh, okay, that's cool.
So,
bougie, okay.
The yeah. So nails are done, y'all.
Yes, but <that's all>.
Lady, but lady, the lady, the white woman, she was next to me, and of course we were distanced. She was like, you know, I remember. First of all, she was talking about salt and pepper.
Salt and Pepper, the rappers?
On the food, child.
Oh, sorry.
That's how we started. And she was like, you know, when I go to my boyfriend's house, because I'm black, so she thought telling me salt and pepper was a seasoning. And I was like, sweetie, no, not in the Haitian household, baby. We got Maggi size on everything else, you know. And y'all got salt and pepper. But anywho, we went into the conversation of, you know, wow, you know, growing up, we had like the floppy disk and we had to go to school with our work saved on that, disk. Yeah. We had the Apple computers with the booty in the back that only could do about four things. It was carrying that booty. Remember when you had to be on the phone call before internet, you would call your friends up. You remember their number. You call your friends up, and then when your mama wanted to peek in on your phone call, she would just go pick it up from the other room.
Yep,
and
I remember that.
5 minutes on what to hear what you were talking about, just to say the big guy eats time for you to get off.
Oh man!
Then when we did get internet, all we were doing was getting it from the mail, using those hours of AOL, whatever, for the time. Nobody was really purchasing. Using those hours of AOL at the time, and then
that's
your mama would kick you off.
That's what
and
I did.
And then when we
she
wanted
to use the phone.
Right. Then when we wanted to download music, LimeWire.
Yeah.
And we were putting viruses on our parents' computers. Okay. And then when we first got cell phones, we had to be at least, you know, maybe 18
Ooh,
or, you know, in school.
I was like 23, and, 24.
And, right, yeah. See, you're a little older than me. You were at 23, 24. I was getting at 18 and had to get the cell phones then. And then it was brick. You had a brick.
Yep.
You had a brick that you only could do Snake on. And then you had to download music so that it could be your ringtone. And then you had three filters, which was probably black and white, sepia, and an original, whatever.
There was none of that back when I got on there.
That was it.
Yeah.
And then this is after the growth of the brick, when we moved on to like the flip phone with the color. And then you had to tell your friend, hey, yo, send me that Bluetooth, right? Bluetooth that song to me. And it was just a little file that you would play on your phone. And that was your ringtone, right?
Yep.
And then like we stopped using the floppy disk and we went to the USBs. And then, we really went through these phases. We really went through these great phases.
But do you really remember those phases?
I remember all of them because I had to deal with all of them.
Do you remember?
I'm an actual 90s kid. So
did you ever have a bill where for text messaging, they should charge you for text? And then you looked up and like, holy crap, I got a $500 bill because of text messages?
Yeah. I charged it to my dad because my dad put me on this plan. Just for a phone call, because we didn't have unlimited back then.
Right.
You could send like 10 text messages.
It was unlimited after 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.
That's when Nextel came in.
Nextel came in with the chirp. So we're like, all right, now I can chirp everybody for free instead of sending text messages or calling.
Yeah. I remember, you remember MySpace? Like that's a little bit more recent, but that's like the first real social media.
And that's what taught us. That's what taught us how to actually code. We didn't even know that we were teaching ourselves how to code at the time, but we were like, page gotta be fly.
Exactly.
Hearts to be coming raining down. I need the music on the side.
I'm gonna go back a little further. I'm gonna go back a little bit further, Rebecca, and see how old you really
are. Black Planet.
MySpace came first.
No, wait, I'm gonna go back even further. GeoCities or GeoSites. Was it GeoCities or GeoSites?
I'm gonna go back even further. College Club.
Are you talking about the? You got me on that one.
I know what you're talking about.
Was the first face? It like literally was the first Facebook, and if I'm not mistaken, College Club migrated and basically turned into Facebook.
I'm thinking you were talking about College Club and FAMU.
There was a place called College Club by somebody on College Club from FAMU. That was so terrible. We used to be catfishing.
Listen, listen. Like back in the day, like
fishing like crazy.
You really put a lot on the line to try to meet up with somebody online because you're like, man, it wasn't. What? You couldn't go and really search somebody. Like, let me cross reference their Instagram with their Facebook. Mm-hmm. Now let me check out their Twitter. And see, you got to do your investigation. Now you got enough to understand if you being catfished. Back in the day, all you had was one person's picture that they emailed you because there wasn't no real social media and you just had to take your chances. I had this way back in college, this one sister from Canada. She was bad. She wanted me to fly up to Canada. She was going to flew me out. And the only reason, I didn't go because I was getting flewed out, but I didn't go because I follow the rule. If you ain't got enough money to get home, don't go. And turn out it probably was a catfish at the end of the day. But yeah, no, it was risky business back in 1998, really.
Yeah. Remember, and we could end with this for hairstyles. Y'all never got the hairstyle. Like even y'all men at the time, boys, and me as a little girl, I was getting bulgogos, the hair bows we called bulgogos in the nerd, which is the ribbons, and with the barrettes at the end. You had your 4, 5, 6 braids with your style, while your friends was having like my friends who would get the perms. I didn't have a perm for a very long time. They would get the swoop in the front like Aaliyah, and my mom would do mine's because my hair was natural. She had like my 2 in the back. But I wanted that swoop in the front like Aaliyah. It would puff right back up. But
I had the box.
I was gonna say, y'all will go and y'all probably wanted certain kind of haircuts, especially the church kids. Y'all probably wanted certain kind of haircuts. And y'all parents was like, hell no, y'all ain't getting two lines on the side.
There used to be a time I had as much hair hanging. You can ask anybody who used to do music. If anybody knows me from when I did music back circa 2004, 2005, I had more hair bounce than Snoop Dogg with my hair. Just, you know, all my fro, pressed that thing, and it was flowing like it was nothing else. But those were many years ago. So
what you say?
Oh, Brian? Wait a minute. Wait, we got him? I was looking like Eazy-E.
Funny.
So, wait, Dwayne, we got anybody in the waiting room? Yeah. So, we'll reschedule. We'll get it together. So, David Sirota, that's our bad. We'll get it right. We'll make it work for the next go round. Because otherwise, we'll be here another 30 minutes and our time has come to an end for the day.
It has come to an end. But it was so good being with y'all on this Flashback Friday, baby. And it was good going through
some of that stuff, know, I don't want to remember, to be honest.
Yeah, some things. But I had a really, I remember days when we were able to go outside. Thank God that our generation liked going outside and things like that. The furthest I can go, though, was to the tree sometimes and back home. But you guys, I'm really, really listen. But look, now I'm going through bad memories. I'm like, I had to stay in the house and I had to ask my parents, could I go outside? But since I'm a girl, I couldn't go outside. And my brothers, they was able to see. Now that's some other thing. Haitians need to do better. But love you guys, mean it.
James.
Please continue to watch the show every day, right here, Monday through Friday, 8:30 to 10:30 a.m. And make sure you never, white people, ever, no black folks. And this is going to be the only way that I educate you on today. Don't ever yell at no black folks to educate you about how you being a racist, okay? And that is my point for you all today. I love you guys. Mean it. Mean Go it. Be great. Bye.
In your lavender. Oh, man.
Oh, man. Bye, y'all. Oh man, awesome show today, y'all. Hope y'all enjoyed it. I know I did. But y'all know what time it is. Good old corporate America. Thank you so much. Yeah, we're walking on cloud
about your love. It's like I've been waiting all around for you. Why did you take so long to come to me? Maybe you were waiting around for me to
you. Cool, that's right. Hashtag free Bubba and free Rebecca.
Rewind, when we rewind, feels so nice. We time, you, I know how to make me feel.
It get a nine, that's right. Slide to the left and slide to the left some more.
I'm already on my way. I'm pulling up, don't be late. I'm cutting through all the lanes. Sweet talk. Oh, you miss my touching. Show me something. Give me more than one thing. I need more than less than I do.
Mama, that song was Walking on Cloud 9 by Sue Zetterberg. Walking on Cloud 9.
I want to see it. See.
Back to the moon. Have a good weekend, T. Have a good weekend. Justice, you know I'm down. Back here on Monday morning, refreshed, energized, and laughing up a damn storm.
I'm already on my way. I'm pulling up, don't be late. I'm cutting through all the lanes.
All right, y'all. Gotta make sure I take y'all out on the jam that we all love, y'all. Here, slide to the left.
Hey, slide to the left, slide to the right. Rock with me, baby, we can do this all night. Slide to the left.
Purple Rain Hearts, I know we working on it.
Come on, come on. Hey, slide to the left, slide to the right. Rock with me, baby, we can do this all night. Slide to the left, slide to the right. Come on, come on, come on. Hey, slide to the left, slide to the right.
Aurora, rock my pleasure, baby, anytime.
Moving sideways on a Friday, DJ playing all of your favorites. I'm digging your flavor, yeah, yeah. There's a vibe. Let this be real inside. Hey, slide to the left, slide to the right. Rock with me, baby, we can do this all night. Slide to the left, slide to the right. Come on, come on, come on.
The only thing I don't like about this song is that it's so damn short.
Baby, we can do this all night.
But all right, y'all, that is going to do it for your boy James Bubba Williams, DJ Exclusive, y'all. Chuck Diesel is over there breaking everything in the house once again. Like it or not, is not responsible for any broken items that is in your household that are played by the music. Anyway, y'all, want to thank y'all so much for tuning in this week. We hope that you enjoyed the week as much as we did. Hell of a good week. Hell of some good shows this week, man. So make sure that y'all go back and replay and rewatch. And then make sure that y'all tune in Monday morning, first time, first thing in the morning, 8:30. Goes down every day, Monday through Friday. Anyway, y'all, I'm out. Have a great weekend. We thank you so much again for tuning in this week. Make sure to hit the like button, share, and subscribe, y'all. Like it or not, we out. Peace. Mwah!